Behold, the d20. With 20 sides, there's a 5% chance that you will roll any given number, from the coveted nat 20 to the dreaded nat 1. But if you're a fan of D&D or any other dice-based tabletop role-playing game, you probably know one person who is infamous for rolling terribly despite the odds. Like, out of 3 separate rolls, they'll get a 2, a 4, and then a 2 again, even when they're using, like, a virtual die. And those things rely on a random number generator to pick which side comes out on top, so it's not even a skill issue. But if such a program is truly random, how can their luck still be so bad? Whoever wrote the code to generate those numbers must not know how the laws of probability work, right? Well, no, they do. But maybe if we all take a moment to learn how random numbers are generated on computers, and how one online platform has gone quantum for their dice rolls, we can set the record straight. There are loads of reasons why you would want a computer to give you a random number. In fields like cryptography and weather forecasting, it is vital that the numbers be truly random. But then there are things like video games and Spotify Shuffle, where people often say they want something random when that's not really true. In physical and virtual casinos, randomness is strictly controlled by law. Like, the house can't cheat shuffle cards in blackjack. Same goes for pulls in mobile gacha games. If you don't know what that is, that's probably for the best. But for shuffling songs on Spotify, it's been known for years that the company tweaks their algorithm to make it less truly random and more in line with what their human listeners think random looks like. That's because people tend to think of random as meaning well spaced out, so the exact same song appearing twice in a row feels less random, even when it really is chosen randomly. The same goes for random chances in video games. Famously, in the series XCOM, there are hidden modifiers that prevent long streaks of bad luck. And in Baldur's Gate 3, the developers added an optional karmic dice setting to avoid too many failed rolls in a row, both for the player and all of the enemies they're battling against. Meanwhile, veteran game designer Sid Meier once said that showing players the odds made them more likely to complain about being let down by random number generators. Human psychology just does not do well with true randomness. Like, I can show you the math and explain, if you roll 3 d20s 8,000 times, you would expect nat 1s to show up on all 3 of the dice about 1 time. And you can buy that, in theory. But then if you ever did get 3 ones on your rolls, you would swear that something fishy was going on. And sometimes, if the dice really are putting a dampener on the D&D storytelling experience, a good DM will fudge things for the sake of having fun with their friends. But let's say you really do want to produce truly random numbers on a computer for something that's a bit more business than pleasure. Say you're looking to calculate how risky a certain investment would be, or you need to model something super complicated like the weather. One very popular tool you could use is something called a Monte Carlo simulation. It's named after the famous casino in Monaco because it uses random numbers like a casino, and its inventor knew someone who was a big gambler. The idea behind a Monte Carlo simulation of any kind, whether you're an entrepreneur or a physicist, is that there's some distribution of numbers you want to learn about. For whatever reason, it's hard to access the full distribution. But if individual samples are a lot easier to get, you can pick those at random using a random number generator, or let's just say RNG. And if you do that sampling enough times, you can learn about the full distribution without having to literally test every possible scenario. But how do you get your computer to choose those samples? It turns out the vast majority of digitally random things, from Spotify Shuffle to Monte Carlo simulations, don't actually rely on truly random numbers. Instead, they are only pseudo-random, generated by pseudo-RNGs. We could easily spend an entire episode talking just about pseudo-RNGs, but the gist is that each one does a bit of math to create a number sequence that looks random. Keyword looks. For example, there are formulas you can use to calculate the digits of pi, 3.1415926, and so on. As you write those digits out, it sure looks like someone just picked a number between 0 and 9 over and over. So for a D&D player who needs to roll a virtual d10 all the time, say a warlock is spamming Eldritch Blast, you could create an RNG where every subsequent roll is just the next digit of pi. However, if that player catches on to you're using that specific formula, all they need to do is figure out where in pi's digits your RNG started to know the results of every future roll they will ever make. The rolls aren't really random. How would they manage to figure that out? I don't know. Maybe their patron told them. Now, if you want some fancy jargon, computers need to use pseudo-RNGs because they are deterministic. That means they can only do pre-programmed specific instructions with predictable outcomes. But that's not, like, automatically a bad thing. There are lots of fancy math functions out there that can create number sequences that are almost indistinguishable from those you would get from a true RNG. They're good enough to use in fields like cryptography, where not being able to predict the next number in a sequence really matters. Pseudo-RNGs work just fine, so long as you choose the starting point of the sequence unpredictably. In the case of our warlock friend, your program might pick the starting point within Pi's digits based on the computer's internal clock, and the exact time they made their first roll. For most purposes, like rolling virtual dice, this is good enough. But if you want true randomness, you have to use something other than a regular computer, and for that, you also have lots of options. But before we get into it, here is a non-randomly selected advertisement.
If you want to learn about randomness and chance, check out Study Hall's new statistics course. Statistics pulls back the curtain on the numbers that explain everything, from medicine to public policy to your role in Baldur's Gate. And with Study Hall, you can earn college credit right here on YouTube. Here's how it works. Watch the statistics course videos on the Study Hall channel for free, then sign up for an online college course led by ASU faculty for just $25 and apply what you've learned. If at the end of the course you're happy with your grade, pay $400, which is about a third of the cost of a college course, to get 3 transferable college credits on your transcript. Whether you're looking to brush up on your math skills, earn college credit, or just prove to yourself that you can do it, Study Hall can help you reach your goals without the financial risk. Check out the link in the description or go to gostudyhall.com to learn more.
If you're looking for a physical system that's a true RNG, dice rolls are a good place to start. People have been using them to generate randomness for millennia, and no human or computer can reliably predict how your dice are going to land. Now, technically, if you knew the exact speed and direction those dice are thrown, you could simulate the roll and calculate the actual result, much like knowing the starting point for a pseudo-RNG. Dice rolls are governed by the laws of classical Newtonian physics, and we know that these laws are deterministic. However, you would need impossible levels of precision in your calculation because even the slightest deviation can totally change which side the dice will land on. To use even more jargon, dice rolls are chaotic, which means in practice, dice rolls are as good as random. So problem solved. If we want a Monte Carlo simulation to accurately predict the weather, all we need to do is work out how to roll a billion dice a second. Or, you know, we could find a different physical system that's just as reliable, just as random, but also much faster. Thankfully, we have several options at our disposal. But before we get into them, we need to distinguish between classical randomness and quantum randomness. Classical randomness comes from us not knowing certain information. A coin toss wouldn't be random if you could calculate its exact path in the air in advance. It would either be heads with 100% certainty or tails with 100% certainty. But for a practical real-world example, the website random.org has been churning out classical random numbers since 1997 using analog radios tuned to unused frequencies. The static noise on those channels is random signals in the atmosphere from stray radio transmissions, particle collisions in the air, and even from the Big Bang itself. That means that despite being classical randomness, the website's numbers are good enough for basically any application, including your friend who needs to roll 10 d6s for their level 5 fireball. But it turns out, there's another kind of randomness in nature, one that is actually fundamental, not just due to a lack of information. This is where the quantum comes in. If you had a quantum mechanical coin toss, say an atom that can either be spinning in one direction or the other, then it truly, genuinely cannot be predicted in advance. Knowing all possible information about this quantum coin pre-toss would not be enough to resolve the ambiguity. The chance really is 50-50. Up until it lands. Or at least, that's what the leading theories tell us. Quantum mechanics has been around for about a century, yet experts are still debating whether any kind of randomness is truly fundamental. But something people don't talk about too often is this. In the real world, quantum systems also have classical randomness. If you've created a quantum coin, you can't guarantee you've prepared it in that exact 50-50 state. Regular old lab problems can change the odds of your quantum coin toss. Like, if the lasers that prepare the atom aren't aligned perfectly, you may end up with, say, 55-45. In other words, you can have classical uncertainty from not knowing what state the coin is in, and quantum uncertainty that is intrinsic to the coin. And those two sources tend to just blend together in any given experiment. So while a variety of quantum RNGs have been available for over a decade, it can be hard to actually prove that they're using true quantum randomness. In 2025, a new paper proved that a specific quantum RNG was truly quantum by using its outputs for a task that only a quantum computer could do. But yes, it was both tricky and time-consuming to test. In fact, all the RNGs we've mentioned still don't produce reliable random numbers fast enough for all of the applications people need them for. Like, random.org actually places quotas on how many numbers you can take from them. They can only generate so many at once. So in 2021, a team of researchers made a new RNG that they claimed could produce hundreds of trillions of fully quantum random numbers per second. Like many other quantum RNGs, this one uses the quantum nature of light. That's because in modern labs, it's easy to quickly and reliably produce light in controlled quantum states, like our quantum coin toss from earlier. And fundamentally, lasers emit individual particles of light using quantum processes, so it's impossible to predict exactly when a single particle will be emitted. Now, usually when making a laser, the point is to make the beam as focused and tight as possible, but the team had the innovative idea to make their laser highly diffuse. By spreading the beam way out, they could randomize not just when, but where particles of light hit a screen at any given moment. So the random number came from seeing whether a point on the screen lit up or not. As for how fast the RNG could produce those numbers, it helped that the team had advanced light detectors that could record random flashes all over the screen at basically a trillion frames per second. All of this might be overkill, but quantum RNGs have found their way to D&D players, or whichever TTRPG floats your boat. In 2022, the virtual tabletop platform Roll20 announced a new feature called Quantum Roll, a quantum guarantee that the dice rolls they produce are as random as possible. They claimed to get those results from a physical quantum source. Now, Roll20 are kind of vague on exactly what kind of quantum system is behind their dice rolls, chalking it up to, quote, quantum fluctuations, which could mean like a few different things. But something to note is that these sorts of quantum RNGs can often be hard to tell apart from classical effects for reasons we discussed earlier. Whether or not those sources are truly quantum, I'm sure D&D players are still going to accuse it of cheating the next time they have a 90% chance to hit that owlbear and whiff it three times in a row.